Technology is a fellow of the Cardiovascular Research Institute. Dr. Kidd's research was funded by the California Heart Association and by the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute of the National Institutes of Health. In 1983, he accepted an opportunity to write a textbook on antioxidants. Was that with Stephen Levine? Mr. Stephen Levine, who is also a speaker here, which later became a classic in the dietary supplement field. Since then, he has pioneered in documenting, developing, and publicizing products from every nutrient category. His PhD thesis was on cell biology of fertilization, a membrane-based phenomenon. He maintained his passion for membranes and cell biology until 1987, a chance came to work on the phospholipids as dietary supplements. He has since pioneered in educating the North American public and health professionals about phospholipids. And recently expanded his perspective to include the omega-3 fatty acids, which are functionally synergistic with the phospholipids. Today he uses his understanding of cell membranes to interpret the remarkable clinical findings on phospholipids and omega-3 fatty acids for brain vitality. I give you Paris Kidd.
Thanks a lot, Mike. It's with a lot of urging from Mike that I came here because it can be an effort for me to step out of my usual rhythm. But I haven't forgotten that my work has no meaning unless it's being applied to people's lives in a daily, ongoing fashion. I have to make my living, but I've always retained my loyalty to the people who take the supplements that I design. You're a very, very smart group. That's why you're here, Smart Life. Already this evening, I've had several sets of interactions that tell me that a lot of you here are smarter than I am. But maybe the reason that I can lecture effectively is because I'm always trying to understand for myself what's really happening. And since I'm not that smart, I figure once I understand it, maybe then I can communicate it to others. Now, tonight we're going to talk mostly about cell membranes. And cell membranes are where life is at. Virtually everything that's really important and interesting about life happens on, or in, or very close to cell membranes. At the very beginning, way, way, way back, the way that life could evolve was that the environment had to be controlled, had to be regulated. And there was no way to regulate the environment unless there was a space that could be defined. And it was the original cell membrane that defined that space. Now, the cell membrane evolved into a system that ramifies throughout the cell. Every cell has membranes. Every cell has an outer membrane and membranes that go in and form an entire network. And these networks form specialized compartments that do specialized tasks. And just to impress upon you how dynamic membranes are, I have a couple of videos for you, and I'll see if I can get them to work. Now, they're very short, and you're just going to get one shot, because I don't know how to back them up. I told you I wasn't very smart. So let's just pray. This one is of nerve cells in culture, and you can see the dynamism of them. Here's a cell body of the neuron. It's putting out. You saw how they put out long extensions that grew out, touched each other, sometimes linked up, sometimes pulled back. Now, all of that is being allowed by the rate and extent through which the cell can add new membrane. As it's growing out, it has to be adding more and more membrane to allow those processes to go out. And it's been shown now, it's clear now from in vivo experiments that as we get stimuli coming into our brain, those stimuli are constantly being integrated and they reinforce circuits. And as the circuits are being reinforced, new synapses are being formed all the time, new connections, new nerve cell contacts, and new networks are being dissolved and formed over the course of minutes, sometimes over seconds. But very, very dynamic system. Now let's see if I can show you.
Paracels time-lapsed, is it?
Yes, it is time-lapsed. And it's probably speeded up about 20 times or so. Yeah, but these things are growing out over the course of minutes and hours. That's not gonna happen. Now here is one that I call the chase video. And this is a neutrophil in culture, an immune cell. And it has sensed the bacterium in its vicinity and it's going after the bacterium. This shows how flexible the membrane can be and how the cell actually turns over membrane with time. And this actually, depending on how good your vitamin C status is, Bob Cathcart will tell you about that. Bob Cathcart, by the way, is my mentor in orthomolecular medicine. There is no other mentor than Bob Cathcart. Bob will tell you that if your vitamin C status is really good, your neutrophils can move almost as fast as this in real time.
Neutrophils are white blood cells that hunt and kill bacteria.
So here it senses the bacteria.
How fast is this when you set up?
This is the head of the cell, this is the tail. The other little bacterium is trying to get away. Right? This guy's just not going to, he's on it. Chemotaxis, mostly. And he gets him, overruns him, takes him in, and within a few minutes, the body of that bacterium will begin to fade as it's being digested. So this is the kind of dynamism that we're talking about. And this is what is happening all the time inside our cells. So now let's talk about how membranes are being built and made to work within the human brain. I'm going to skip this one. It is kind of pretty, but I'll skip it because it's a little bit late. So you know who I am. So here we have then the outer membrane, so-called cell membrane. And then inner membranes include the nuclear envelope, which is actually two membranes, which encloses the genes. And it turns out that the genes are all attached at one point or another to the inner face of the nuclear envelope. And there are enzymes in those membranes that carry out repair and replication of DNA and production of RNA that's going to cause protein as well. DNA is not the master, but I don't think there is really a master biologically. I think the spirit is the master, and I think that I wasn't here for Bruce Lipton's talk, but from what I heard, it sounds like it was a really, really good talk. It's our spirit that really runs the show, and it's amazing how our cells can either conform or rebel, depending on how the spirit wants to handle them. I also really appreciated Mr. Field's presentation. It was a refreshing chunk of honesty that didn't have to involve science, not a lot of science anyway. And I can tell you that science can be done honestly and it can be done dishonestly. You know what they say about lies, damn lies, and statistics. And I made a mental point of telling you this tonight, that conjugated linoleic acid is toxic. I did a report for a client, you know, I'm a corporate consultant, I'm a corporate hitman. Did a report for a client, concluded that CLA was toxic, client comes back, argues with me, no, it can't be so, because we're selling $5,000 a month, so it can't be, 5,000 bottles a month, so it can't be toxic. There's no way it can be toxic. So I said, Okay, and then the reports came out of Norway and another country in Europe that indeed, yes, it is toxic. And then the manufacturers start to put out more papers to try to show that it's not toxic. But interestingly, the free radical breakdown products that are found when a person takes CLA are not being measured in the studies done by the manufacturers. So previous reports come out, 5 human trials come out, some of them double-blind, in showing very clearly that CLA raises free radical end products, lipid peroxides, isoprostanes, C-reactive protein. The manufacturers do a study over 2 years and they don't measure those things. Instead, they measure things like LDL, HDL. Even those don't look so good in the study, but they say, well, you know, there's a little bit of a bad trend with LDL and HDL, but basically it's not going to kill you. But that's sort of an example of how science can be abused. I'm really very angry about it. Technically, my report to the client is confidential, but I think enough time has gone by that I could publish it. But then where do I get the legal fees? Where do I get the legal fees to fight something like that? And you better believe, you really need to understand this, that even my clients who don't carry CLA are going to be hesitant to step in and pay my legal fees. I learned that lesson from germanium too. So you have to look at everything with a grain of salt, even what I'm saying tonight. I have financial involvement with all 3 of the products that I'm talking about with you tonight. I'm presenting you the science. If you wish to follow up, you'll get my email address. We can discuss it and so on. I'm trying to stay on solid ground with the science, even while I understand that science is not God. A lot of scientists worship science, but science is just an attempt by human culture to systematize subjective stimuli. That's really all it is, and it shouldn't be more than that, although it's what I do for my living. So then we have the Golgi membranes that produce and package up proteins and certain other secretory products and release them to the outside. We have the mitochondria, which generate energy, and actually in most cells these are much more extensive, and the more active the cell, the more extensive the mitochondria to generate enough energy for things to happen. And then the molecules that are the main building blocks of membranes are the phospholipids. So here you see an outer cell membrane, and you see it has 2 layers of molecules. The red in the interior is 2 sets of tails of phospholipids. So you have phospholipid heads on the outside and the inside, and then the tails face inward. So you have 1 and 2 layers that make up each membrane. And then there's a little bit of cholesterol to give a little bit of glue in the membrane. Yes, we do need cholesterol for lots of reasons. And then there are proteins of various types that sit, that are embedded in the body of the phospholipids in the matrix. And the presence of the phospholipids, the physical and chemical structure of the phospholipids, provide a microenvironment for each protein specifically to carry out its functions. So a healthy membrane will provide the appropriate microenvironment for each protein to function. Now we're talking about thousands of different proteins in each cell membrane with its own needs that are supplied by the phospholipids in its immediate vicinity. The phospholipids also make the body of the lipoproteins, the LDL, HDL, and so on. They provide a matrix with some cholesterol. There's cholesterol, the green is phospholipids, the yellow is cholesterol. And then the red, in this case, I believe this is an LDL molecule. So maybe it's an HDL, because it has lots and lots of esterified cholesterol inside of it. So the LDL and HDL are made by phospholipids. The liver uses phospholipids to package up LDL and HDL. And there is no good cholesterol and bad cholesterol. There's only a good liver and a not so good liver. So if your liver is really functioning well, it's going to handle your lipoproteins. The LDL exists for a reason. The LDL take important nutrients that are of a fatty nature from the liver out to the tissues. The HDL takes recycled cholesterol and certain other things, brings them back to the liver. It's all a cycle. There is no bad and good cholesterol. That's not the story. The real story is, how well is your body working to manage that system? And if you're taking all kinds of nutrients and doing all the right things and your cholesterol is not going down, there are a couple of reasons. One, you could be hereditarily hypercholesterolemic, which means you do have a problem. You may need a more aggressive intervention. Or it may mean that you just need to detoxify your liver and do some other basic stuff. Go to Bob, get a few IBCs, you know, clean things out. C is a great detoxifier, by the way. It's underrated for that purpose, I think. So here then we have these stretches of membrane throughout the cell and carrying the lipoproteins, and there are three phospholipids that I'm going to talk about today. Phosphatidylcholine is the main building block phospholipid. So it has a head group that consists of choline, which happens to be an essential nutrient also, and phosphate, and a middle piece which is made of glycerol, and then two tails which are made of fatty acids. And yes, these fatty acids can be omega-6 or omega-3 or other types of fatty acids. So PC is the main building block of all membranes. PS has serine in its head group, and PS is found more in the brain. But it's also found throughout all the cells of the body and in every living thing down to the most primitive bacteria. So PS and PC are primal building blocks of membranes all the way up from the very beginning of life. But I'm also going to talk about GPC, which is PC that doesn't have the two tails. And this is a very interesting molecule because it's not sitting in membranes. It's actually sitting in the water phase of the cell, and it gets to very, very high concentrations. It's protective, and it assists with a number of functions, but it's very easily converted to PC. With almost no energy, two tails can be added on to GPC using enzymes that are around the membrane to make PC, and then we're good to go. So these are the three phospholipids I'm going to talk about, mostly PS and GPC, and these are the three that are commercially available. PC is not so relevant to the brain, that's why I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it tonight, but PC works like a whiz for the liver. And let me just say something really quickly about the liver, because I know that you're the group that can appreciate it. The liver has cells that have huge masses of cell membrane inside. And those membranes are used to carry out the detoxification and 499 other functions that the liver carries out. The liver is the workhorse organ of the body. The liver is doing all the grunt work, all the heavy lifting. And if you would spread out all the membrane surface of a human liver, it would cover around 4 football fields. Now, when a liver is damaged, when liver cells are killed, the deal is to replace those cells as quickly and as extensively as possible. And the only way that can be done is to add on a lot of membrane all at once. And the phospholipid to do that with is PC. So we find that while PC is kind of ho-hum for the brain, for the liver, it works very, very nicely. And it may be the single best nutrient for recovery from liver damage. Although I would advocate that in any of these cases, we're talking about a complete program. We're not talking about any one nutrient that's going to do the whole job. And please don't take anything that I say tonight to suggest that any of these are panaceas or that they have the whole story. In some of my discussions tonight, I've heard, you know, boron. Is boron bad or is it good? Boron is an essential mineral. If we don't have it, we're not well. It's not a question whether it's bad or good. It's an essential mineral. We need it. Questions like that. Is so-and-so going to cure cancer? Is so-and-so going to lower cholesterol? It's not about that. It's about how you live your life. And that's where your spirit comes in. You have got to do, it's very hard to get the body from a sick state into a well state. And you have to do everything that's in your power, everything you can do, not just taking dietary supplements, not just taking some nutrient that somebody tells you is really good. You've got to do everything you can, and you've got to figure out all the things that you need, starting with the essential nutrients, the essential, the vitamins and minerals, and then the conditionally essential nutrients, and so on and so on. Now, the omega-6 and omega-3 fatty acids are pretty much vitamins. They just didn't happen to be discovered back in the 30s, and they're not water phase, but they're basically vitamins because only a very small percentage of us can make them from their precursors. And they work only through phospholipids, and they work only in the membranes. Very important to understand this. It is through the cell membranes that the essential fatty acids do what they do. And they give fluidity to the membrane. Now, as we get older, we tend to get more rigid membranes. The membranes tend to be less flexible. It's almost like our personalities. As our personalities go to hell, so do our membranes. But it is possible to slow that and perhaps even to stabilize it using long-chain omega-6 and omega-3 fatty acids. So fluidity is very important. There's a formation of messenger substances called eicosanoids, which are sort of colloquially known as prostaglandins, but they're much more than that. And then there's the whole issue of the membrane being able to transduce stimuli, the membrane picking up stuff from the outside and changing it into signals that the cell can understand on the inside. And then based on all of those functions, we get other levels of activity that then lead to the cell functioning in the manner that it needs to function. Now, this just happens to say inflammation and immunity, but we're also talking about all the nerve cell initiation of electrical stimuli, propagation of stimuli, and so on. But do let me say that imbalance of the omega-6 fatty acids is very much linked to systemic inflammation. And a couple of years ago, I thought I had finally got a good idea. I thought I finally had the idea that was going to get me recognition. I was going to be somebody, finally. And the deal was that I had reviewed pretty much all the brain diseases, and I had reviewed cardiovascular and all these things, and bone and prostate. And everywhere I looked, I saw inflammation. And I decided, wow, inflammation causes or contributes to all disease. I've got it. And then I run into a gentleman named Virchow, who lived way back in like 1860 or something, and he already had it figured out. Rudolf Virchow. He already had it figured out way back then. So I'm a little bit late, but I gotta tell you that in terms of your daily existence, control over inflammation, and particularly setting your inflammatory balance, your inflammatory poise, is critical to your health. If you're operating on a pro-inflammatory poise, you're in trouble. Something is going to get you, and you're going to be in trouble earlier than you had wanted. If you're on an anti-inflammatory poise, and especially if you're taking a lot of antioxidants, then you can kick back. Kick back a little bit, you know, do your exercise, you know, have a positive spirit. And then the clock ticks, and just very, very slowly, as the free radical end products slip through the net, you will age. But in theory, you can get beyond 120. Probably not our generation, but our kids maybe. Like, my daughter does everything right. And I have a feeling that she could well get to 110 or 120. I won't be around to see that because I don't do everything right. But the fact is that if you want to be on an anti-inflammatory poise, and if you are, then you have a chance to have a long life with good quality. If you're on a pro-inflammatory poise, whether or not you have clinical symptoms, you're headed for trouble. And I'm going to develop that as we go along, with special regard to the brain. But the message from this slide is that the omega-3 and omega-6 fatty acids are an integral part of the phospholipids, and they work in no other way, and they require the phospholipids to hold them in place within the membrane in order for them to be accessed by the appropriate enzymes. And membranes really do run our metabolism. Very interestingly, across the vertebrate species, the more unsaturated our membranes, that is, the more omega-6s and omega-3s they have, is the faster the metabolic rate. So guys like lizards and Komodo dragons and stuff, you know, they're slow. And the reason they're slow is not just because they're supposedly cold-blooded, but even when they're in the sun and they're hot, their membranes are sufficiently saturated that they can't turn their proteins around fast enough. They can't make their proteins move. Their membranes are not sufficiently fluid to achieve the rate of transformation that we can achieve. Think of it as an auto assembly line, and a line that's kind of hung up by slow machinery versus a line that's just moving right along. So the more omega-6s and omega-3s we have, as a rule, the better off we are. And so this enables the enzymes, the receptors, transporters to work better. And well, this business of transfer of more energy, people like Burns and Steve Fox would like, but I won't stay on it too long. But the big player in terms of fluidity is DHA, because it has six double bonds, and it is the most fluidizing of all the long-chain fatty acids. And nothing really substitutes very well for DHA. And I want to show you that here are the various important fatty acids that are unsaturated. And so we can have those with one double bond. We can have those with two double bonds. We can have those with three, and so on. But the two big players in our physiology are arachidonic acid. Well, actually, there are three. Arachidonic acid, which is omega-6, EPA, and DHA. But when you look at this diagram, you see that the insertion on the phospholipid is over here. So it's facing this way into the core of the membrane. Now, the core of the membrane is very important because that's where CoQ lives, for one thing. Within this area, there's virtually no water, virtually no positive or negative charge, so to speak, or to speak of. And the fatty acid that extends deepest into the membrane is DHA. And it's the most fluidizing of all. So by having DHA present, we give more fluidity to the innermost part of the membrane than any of the others. Now, interestingly, when the body is deficient in DHA, these two molecules can be used. An omega-6, which has five double bonds, it's called DPA, and then an omega-3, which has five double bonds. So our membranes seem to work to maintain fluidity, and they can substitute for DHA to some extent, but it's best to have the DHA itself. And alpha-linolenic acid from flaxseed oil is not a good substitute for the longer chain omega-3s. In fact, there's reason to believe that it interferes with the action of EPA and DHA. What this means in practical terms is that flaxseed oil is okay to put on your salad every now and then, but it is not going to substitute for fish oil on an ongoing basis. Gotta have the fish oil, whether you get it as a supplement and or get it through meals, which we'll get into a bit more later. But the people who are aggressively promoting flaxseed oil are neglecting a huge body of evidence that suggests that it is not particularly useful with the possible exception of helping the quality of the skin. But when you look at the cell membranes, they don't seem to particularly need or appreciate having a lot of linoleic acid around. And interestingly, flaxseed, whole flaxseed, seems to be pretty much anti-cancer, the whole flaxseed. But the extracted flaxseed oil apparently is promoting of cancer. So let me now just quickly run through phosphatidylserine. I'm already running very late. But just to remind you that PS has the serine on the head group. And then PS tends to have a saturated or monounsaturated fatty acid on position 1, which kind of anchors it in the membrane. And yes, saturates are good for us. We need a certain amount of saturates precisely for this reason. They're good anchors in the membrane. And then often on position 2, it carries DHA. And it's been suggested that the PSDHA phospholipid is one of, if not the most important molecule in the human brain. So PS is an orthomolecule, as I mentioned. It is intrinsic to our metabolism. It's found in all life forms, particularly enriched in the brain. It has proven efficacy for memory and cognition, for mood and stress management, and it has no apparent adverse effects. I've been working with it since 1994, and I haven't had one call suggesting adverse effects from PS. It doesn't have any soy protein in it, made from soy, but the phospholipids are cleared of protein, so there's no particular soy allergenicity. Now, as we get older, our memory is gonna decline. Dr. Thomas Crook is one of the world's foremost leaders in memory testing, and he has developed common sense testing where you sit in front of a screen and you get a bunch of faces, and then they go off, and then some time goes by, and then you got to identify on another screen the faces that you saw before, and you get names, so you have to do face recall, name recall, name face recall, telephone number recall, where do you put your keys on the map of the house or the TV, you know, stuff like that, where are your glasses, comprehending a paragraph. Turns out that comprehending a paragraph is a very good indicator of predilection to severe memory decline. If you find, but the main thing really is when the people around you begin to say, you know, Uncle Paris, my friends call me Doc too, and say, you know, Doc, he's losing it a little bit, you know, he saw Bob Cathcart the other day, didn't remember Bob's name and stuff like, you know, Doc isn't doing so well. When other people begin talking about you, that's when you know you really have a problem. But this is a presentation of 14 names and faces, and you get four tries. You get three tries, I think, 5 minutes between, and then you get like a half an hour delay. So if you're, my daughter is now 29, she's getting to the top edge, but if you're 18 to 29, you're getting about 12 right out of 14. Some people in this room would have got 13 or 14 right. Maybe they still would. Then if you're in your 30s, you go down 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s. This has been validated across several cultures, and so it holds up across the cultures. And by the time a person's in their 70s, they're only getting 4 right out of 14. And based on this, one can be assigned a functional age. That is, your score can be compared to the score of people in your age group, and depending on how far you are above or below the average, you can be given a functional age. So for example, I'm 80 years old, and my functional age was assessed at about 69, right? Bob Cathcart is 110 years old, and his functional age is more like 40, right? You know, every time I give a talk and he's here, I harass him. It's because I love him so much. I learn so much from the guy, you know? Because I came out of this really conservative academic world, you know, where science was to be worshipped, and yet they were cheating. And they were killing animals without anesthesia. And I got to a point where I couldn't do it anymore. And I didn't want to be co-author on a paper where I knew the data were fudged. And so one day I just walked out. That's how I left academia. One day I walked out, I took my retirement money and bought a computer and stuff. So I learned a lot from Bob. I knew Carl Ebnother. I wish I had met Roy Walford. And I believe that these people have pioneered what we have now as patient empowerment. And even though they are physicians, I know that all of you in the room love them and respect them. And you know, I know that when I go to see Bob, I can bare my heart and my body to him, and he will be like my tax consultant, you know? He's not telling me what to do, he's strongly advising me, right? So, you know, if I'm smart, I take his advice, right? You know, makes sense. But basically, very honest, very supportive, very decent human beings. And they're the ones that started this movement. See, Bob, we should have done that book. Finding the Bill is gonna pass now. So you can get a functional age assigned. And when a trial was done, people were recruited by Dr. Crook, people above the age of 50, who were scoring in the lowest 5 or 10% for their age group. And they were said to have age-associated memory impairment. They were not doing well. And then they were put in a double-blind trial with PS, and the entire group did better on PS, but within that group who were not doing well, those who were at the very bottom were the ones who did best with PS, and those happen to be the ones who are at risk for dementia. Now, those of you who take phosphatidylserine probably realize that it's helping you with your word recall, it's helping you with your focus, your short-term memory and so, and when you come off of it is when you really feel it. But these people are people who, unless they would have a really aggressive intervention with PS and with lots and lots of other nutrients, probably would proceed into dementia. So we're talking about heading it off before it happens. Now here's an Alzheimer's brain. I had my brain done. This is the SPECT scanning, which is a functional scanning. You get injected with a dye, with a radioactive label, and you sit for a few minutes. Maybe you take a test. I flunked my test, but you take an attention test and so. And after 15 minutes, they come and they scan you and so on and so on and so on. And what it is that where the brain is working, you see solid contour. Where it's not working, the tissue is there, but it's not functioning. So it's like, metabolically, there's a big hole there. And with Alzheimer's, you get holes all over. You know, temporal, parietal, frontal, everywhere. This is just looks really, really bad. And in fact, it is bad. A person with Alzheimer's is losing about 10% of their nerve cells every decade. And by the end of their life, they might have only 10% left of the original 100%. And that's why education is good, because apparently, the more complicated the circuitry you have earlier in life, is the more connections you have in your bank. And the more connections you have in your back, the more withdrawals you can afford. You just don't want to do an overdraft, such as I did to some extent in my earlier life, and I'm paying a price for it now. The Amen Clinics, Dr. Daniel Amen, has a network in California where he does these scans. They're not cheap, but I found out a lot about my brain. I can tell you, I had a hole I didn't even know about. He says it's a brain trauma where I got hit. And then I remembered that once I fell off my bike, and I fell real hard on asphalt, I wasn't wearing a helmet, and I thought I was okay, but it looks like that was when I really clunked something. So I got a big hole somewhere right about here. But he says it's partly healed over, so, you know, we've made some progress. Now, here's a different type of scan of Alzheimer's. This is a PET scan, and this is glucose consumption by the brain on three levels. This is a woman with Alzheimer's, 59 years old, and at the beginning, she's not using very much sugar. In the blue here, she's using like 15 to 25 units per unit time, whatever. And after 3 weeks on a high dose of PS, she's using a whole lot more, pretty much throughout her brain. She's gone into the yellows and reds. And in this study, I believe 5 out of 8 people experienced very marked, I believe between 8 and 12% improvement in glucose utilization across the brain.
What would normal look like?
Well, normal should be pretty much yellow throughout with some red. You know, in a normal, these areas would also be yellow, and there'd be other areas that had quite a bit of red. But she's made a lot of progress in 3 weeks. Now, according to Dr. Crook's measurements from that age-associated memory impairment study, it's possible that PS can recover between 4 functional years and 14 functional years if the population is a population that has not proceeded into dementia. There have been trials done with Alzheimer's, and PS will benefit recall, it will benefit mood, it will benefit sociability in Alzheimer's, but it's not turning Alzheimer's around. And I don't know of any single intervention, not even a combination of interventions, that will turn Alzheimer's around. Luckily, we're proceeding to the point where we can pretty much predict it. Hippocampal size is one estimate. And then if a person has a small hippocampus and they score poorly on Alzheimer's assessment tests, pretty much they're classed as mild cognitive impairment, which the FDA now recognizes as a prodrome for Alzheimer's. That's kind of the last point at which to step in. And I can't decide whether I'm AAMI or MCI, but I do know that I need help. And it's very important to accept that you need help. Very important. PS is very good for mood and for helping to keep cortisol regulation under control. And here's a study that was done with stress, done at the University of Montreal. They recruited people between the ages of 55 and 65. And they classified them into 2 groups. One group were the uptight ones, the ones who were anxious, you know, always worried about something, like me. You know, I always find something to worry about. High level of ongoing cortisol, just, you know, really struggling to perceive life. To cope with what they perceive as a difficult life. And the other group now, like Bob or Steve or Bernd or Mike, laid back, not worried about anything. They have problems, but they're coping with them. You know, come what may, right? Now, those groups go 2 separate ways over 5 years. The uptight ones have a steadily shrinking hippocampal volume, and their cortisol goes up over the years as well. And as their cortisol trends up over the years, their cognitive function trends down, pretty much parallel with their hippocampal volume. And we have a lot of experimental work. If you haven't heard about it, you can read Dr. Sapolsky's book. His classic, Robert Sapolsky's classic, Why Zebras Don't Get Ulcers. We don't have time to get into it today, but we have a lot of work indicating that stress literally burns away the hippocampus and probably parts of the cortex as well. So if you perceive that you're under stress on an ongoing basis, you need to come to terms with it now. Okay, so we talked about PS benefiting energy consumption across the brain. There have been a number of trials on old and young subjects indicating that PS improves people's perception of stress while they're under challenge. In one trial, they gave university students, young university students, a complicated arithmetic calculation to do without a calculator. Now, you know, when I was in school, we didn't have calculators. You know, I had to do it in my head anyway. That's why I always learned math. Or almost not math. But these kids are used to calculators now, so they had to do these tests without calculators. And again, there were 2 groups. The ones who had reported in advance that they tended to be neurotic, they had scored neurotic on a questionnaire. The uptight ones did very well on PS. The PS helped to calm them down, and they got through the calculation a lot better off than when they were not at PS. So PS does help with coping with stress. And in older people, it seems to perform some degree of revitalization of what we call the HPAA, the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis that altogether manages stress. So old people in studies also did better. They slept better, their body rhythms were better, and so on. Gonna skip over this one, four trials on stress in young people. And then I did, with my dear friend Dr. Richard Cunyon, and with a very nice physician in Kansas City named Dr. Carol Ann Reeser, I did altogether collaborated on three small studies of kids. We gave kids who had ADHD or other behavioral problems, PS. And essentially we found that the majority of them, the vast majority of them, were benefited. Actually, the three trials add up to about 36 or so out of 40 or so. These kids all benefited on PS at a pretty high dose. It took 4 months. And this was adding PS on top of what they were already getting. In other words, we were not able to persuade the parents. We didn't want to persuade the parents to take their kids off of the B vitamins and antioxidants and omega-3s and sometimes Ritalin. But we added the PS on top of that, and we got a very high rate of response. Only a pilot trial, not a controlled trial. But I'm hoping that we will do more on this in the future.
Noticeably or a lot? Or?
Oh, very much so, very much so. In fact, if any of you have been to Dr. Cunyon's practice, you know that in that basement there's a board, a pool table, and Richard had this idea that we should bring all the parents and their kids at once and have a little meeting with them. I don't know where this came from, but so on this Saturday morning, we had these five totally out of control kids and their parents. And the parents apparently were in a state of non-intervention. They had given up, I guess. So they were sitting around reading the paper, and the kids were picking up the billiard balls all over the room. And I thought, oh no, somebody is going to get hurt. I hope it's not me, but I sure hope that Dr. Cunningham and I don't get sued this morning. But these kids were really crazy. I remember one had those little lights going on his shoes, you know, running around and so, and they broke a couple of Richard's statuettes in the room. But when they came back at 3 months, those kids could sit quietly in his office and play. And just, they were really very different kids. And the first ones that noticed were their grandmothers. Usually the grandmothers noticed first that there was improvement. And so, we believe it was a real finding, and I'm hoping that at some point we'll be able to do more of this. And Dr. Reeser in Kansas City found out the same thing. There's a little boy, son of a lawyer. I don't know if that's why maybe he's so freaked out, but anyway, when this little guy would be on PS, he'd be fine. He'd do well in school, he'd behave himself. And a couple of times they ran out of PS, and within 3 days he was back to his old devilish self. So. Anyway, maybe that's what you get, you know, for...
Have you seen any uses of it with dyslexia and improving brain function in those capacities?
No, but I have reason to believe it would work, and we're going to get to the omega-3s and discuss that. Mike, how much more time are you going to give me?
15 minutes.
Okay, that's all I got. All right, how does PS work? Well, the real truth is that nobody knows. I'm not even sure I have a clue as to how PS works. I know a lot of ways that it doesn't work, but I have a suspicion that it's working through some interaction with growth factors. Now, very interesting thing, this just shows you that if you give rats PS as they get older, they lose almost none of their nerve cell size and volume, whereas if they don't have PS, they lose a lot. So this is negative going down this way. But the brain, if the brain has any degree of health, is continually making growth factors. And these factors essentially are there to to stimulate the cells, to put out more processes, more dendrites, make more synapses and so. But they need to be stimuli for that. And that's why we say use it or lose it. So the more that's coming in, the more that's happening from the environment, is the more of a chance that the growth factors are going to turn on the cells and get them to make more connections. And for that, they need more nutrients. One of the nutrients they need is PS. Another set of nutrients they need is DHA and EPA, but especially DHA. And they may also need GPC. But I believe that PS is working through the growth factors. And an experiment was done on aging rats. And you have rats that get old with elegance. They go through a kind of gracious aging where they're still performing pretty well on tests, and their nerve growth factor capability is still pretty high, so they're called non-impaired. But then you have the Alzheimer's rats, and they're not doing well at all. They perform badly on the tests, and their growth factors are down, their growth factor receptiveness is down. And when you give these Alzheimer guys, well, you start in midlife, but when you give these guys PS, you can bring up their growth factor density all the way to high normal. Similar findings for GPC as well. So, and there are other clues that tell me that apparently PS is helping with growth factor activity. But what that does mean, though, is that you can't sit back and do nothing. You can't just do what I do, you know, watch the History Channel, tell lies and stuff. You know, you need to actually, you know, luckily I have my science, you know, I can, you know, I read my science and stuff, you know, but it's really amazing. They just rewrote the Kennedy assassination last week. We do have stem cells. We do have stem cells in the brain, and in animals, we found them in the human brain. We haven't yet proven that they will differentiate in the human brain. We have every reason to believe they will. In animals, we can get some stem cell differentiation, and that depends on how many little toys we give them in their cage, and how many colors we give them, little things to play with, and giving them a treadmill. They need both mental stimulation and physical activity, and then their stem cells will convert within the hippocampus, and I'm praying for mine, I'm telling you, I'm really praying for my hippocampus, and then to some extent in other parts of the brain. So the brain can repair itself, and I believe it does, but it needs the right nutrients, and it needs a lot of stimulation. So what is GPC then? Well, GPC is also kind of choline without the tails. And very interestingly, GPC is one of these rare molecules in the body that has both a positive charge, my little thing is burning out, I guess, but you see a positive charge up there, a negative charge down here. There are a few others, like, for example, taurine, that have that capacity. But essentially, that makes it a fantastic cell protectant. And that's probably part of the explanation for why GPC works as much as it does. It's highly bioavailable. It gets into the brain very, very quickly. It raises the levels of choline throughout the body and in the brain, crosses the blood-brain barrier, and it backs up acetylcholine as well. And it is also readily converted from GPC into PC that goes into the membrane. So there's been quite a lot of clinical work done on GPC. This is just to show you that its protective action is especially evident in the kidney, where as you go from the cortex of the kidney and the urea builds up, the concentration of GPC builds up, and it gets to a very, very high level, which is like 10 times or 11 times the highest level of glutathione, which is one of the most concentrated molecules in the body. So GPC is very, very important in kidney, liver, brain, as well as in muscle, and even for male fertility. I'm going to go through it very, very quickly. We have experiments in young people. We have trials, double-blind trials in young people, indicating that it benefits their attention and other aspects of mental performance. It works pretty well in dementia. It works twice as well as certain nutrients and drugs. It outperformed a CoQ analog, an aniracetam and oxiracetam, so-called smart drugs, outperformed acetylcholine and citicoline. This nutrient, citicoline, is being heavily promoted, even though it doesn't really work. Citicoline may find a place for glaucoma, but I don't think it's ever going to be, in terms of evidence, a good brain nutrient. But a lot of money is being spent to promote citicoline. And the people who are promoting citicoline forget to mention that there have been 3 controlled clinical trials that directly compared citicoline against GPC, and in all 3 cases, GPC worked better than citicoline. In an extensive in-depth review, they forgot to mention those 3 trials, which are prominently published in the peer-reviewed literature. So you see, you can't believe everything that people say. If you like the references, I'll send them to you. Very, very safe, no real problems with it. Occasional tummy effect in a fraction of 1% of the patients. GPC has seen trials in more than 4,000 patients. It has worked very nicely for stroke, and there's a big literature on GPC used first by injection and then as a nutrient for brain injury. People who have had traumatic brain injury, you start them off with injected GPC for a month and then you switch them to the oral. But I have every reason to believe that people who have had a stroke or who have other impairment due to brain damage could go on to the oral GPC and derive some benefit. There's also evidence that growth hormone decline may be subject to some modulation using GPC. It was used as an injectable, and trials on an oral basis need to be done, but they haven't been done yet.
What about dermal? So you're not going through the liver and metabolizing it?
GPC?
Yes, using it in a topical way to bring it in.
You don't need to bypass the liver because the liver uses it too. I mean, the liver routes it, you know. Okay. I think we should let the liver do its job, but I think we should try and keep the liver clean. You know, I think we should have a lot of respect for our livers. Yeah, we really should. You know, it's boring, you know. I remember when I would dissect and I would see it, you know, it's kind of ugly and so, but it's jammed with membranes, a very, very busy organ. So it's very, very good for stroke. We have a number of trials on almost 3,000 patients in which GPC benefited pretty much all aspects that could be measured over a period of 6 months. Uniquely effective against stroke. A double-blind trial was done on patients coming out of cardiac bypass. I don't know if you know this, but around 50%, sometimes more, of people who go into cardiac bypass surgery come out a bit addled. Some of them bounce back immediately or after weeks, and others never quite come back. And some of them can be pretty badly off. So a double-blind trial was done in which GPC benefited these cardiac bypass patients. Now I have badly off, then you might want to consider this. I'm sorry Bob Atkins didn't have a shot at this, because I found one study from Russia in which they gave like 10 grams of GPC IV to comatose patients, and they got them to pull out of the coma at an institute that handles astronauts and stuff, the Burdenko Institute. But that's in my review, so I'm going to just skip on from that. There's a handout there. Somebody wanted to... yes, quick question?
I had an injury 24 years ago. Did it help me? Had an injury 24 years ago. This week, coma. No motor skills, no balance.
Yeah, you know, it's been shown, maybe you know this, you probably know this, but it's been shown that cells in the brain can be in shock for 10 years or more following a stroke. So you can have cells that are alive but aren't functioning, and you can shock them back into action using hyperbaric oxygen But I suspect that, you know, if you would do everything that you could, including these nutrients we're talking about today, you'd have a better chance to get back some of them or a majority of them. By the way, I'm taking all of these things myself. You know, I'm on a rebuild program. I really am, Bob. You think I'm not kidding? I'm not kidding. Yeah. Yeah. Again, GTC, adult animals, their nerve growth factor receptors. Old animals, the nerve growth factor receptors go down. You give the old animals GTC, the nerve growth factor receptors go back up. So there's something going on between these phospholipids and nerve growth factor capacity. GPC also has a privileged relationship with DHA in that DHA can be added on to GPC with virtually no energy expended. It's just like flip. If the DHAs are wrong, it can be put onto the GPC to go into the membrane. And just to get the men awake tonight, maybe a few of the women too, men who have poor sperm motility have low amounts of GPC in their semen. And GPC is quite intimately involved in maturation of sperm. So that in the epididymis, as sperm are being made, GPC is combined with DHA to make a PC-DHA, and that apparently is what allows, or much of what allows the sperm tail to move as dynamically as it does, you know, to lay down that standing wave and push the sperm forward and so. And then, when the sperm gets into the cervix, the lining of the cervix secretes an enzyme which breaks down GPC and allows it to then be used for energy, and that energy apparently helps the sperm to become what we call capacitated. Their little heads open up and then they're capable of fertilizing an egg. So GPC seems to be very involved in fertilization, and especially in combination with omega-3 DHA. When you look at the literature on the brain and everything to do with dynamism in the other organs, you find DHA. So, I guess by now I only have about 5 minutes. So GPC works very well for people of all ages to sharpen them up and help them to rebuild. And now we get to the omega-3s. The omega-3s are, maybe this is a take-home message on the omega-3s. You need the omega-3s for everything at every stage of your life, period. For all of your organs, and for early development, for development after birth, and for what I speak of as plasticity, for the brain being able to remold and replace circuits as we get older.
Harris, why fish?
Well, why not fish?
Well, what happens if you live in an area like in the Midwest somewhere where you don't have fish per se, you know?
Well, you can get algal DHA, but you're not getting the EPA. And from what I see, we do need both. I don't know that there's a magic ratio of them, but we do need both DHA and EPA. And by far the easiest source is certain cold water fish. And I suppose if you're in the Midwest and you can't get the fish, then you should buy the supplement.
So what did they do for centuries when they didn't have all this?
Actually, humankind first evolved around lakes that had fish that were rich, fairly rich in omega-3s. And maybe that's why we've had all these wars through all these millennia. Maybe we were just stupid all the way along. But there's an argument that has been made, a quite cogent argument, that the early expansion of the primate brain had to do with and was limited by the availability of omega-3s in the diet. Now, it may be that back in those days we could do a better job with alpha-linolenic from flaxseed, but right now it looks like only about 10, 15, 20% of people can take the flaxseed alpha-linolenic and get it all the way to DHA. I've prepared most of this presentation on mood because I'm having some mood problems myself, I did a major review, a big review on bipolar disorder, which is also on my website, published in Alternative Medicine Review. And there's one trial with the omega-3s that was really pivotal, and a double-blind placebo-controlled trial, and it showed significant reduction in the severity of depression. But look at how much EPA and DHA it had. It gave 10 grams, really a very huge amount of EPA and DHA. If you do a kind of survival graph, which really means remission of bipolar, with the omega-3 fatty acids, over a period of 4 months, you had just a few people who were falling back into bipolar symptomatology, whereas the placebos slipped back very, very quickly. And there's other circumstantial evidence indicating that it is good for mood. Some of the people who had bipolar disorder, even Virginia Woolf, right? And who can guess who this guy is? You know who that is?
Kurt Cobain.
Right. Well, that's what can happen when a person's mood becomes so troubled and so desperate. And many others with bipolar have done it. The lifelong risk of suicide in bipolar subjects is 15%. 15% lifelong risk of actually doing it, not just talking about it or token and stuff, but actually doing it. Dr. Amen's imaging shows that people with ADHD tend to have hot spots all throughout their cortex and in some of the deeper areas of the brain. So the red hair is overactive. Activity. And the ADHD type pattern looks a lot like the bipolar pattern. These are two bipolar subjects here. And Dr. Amen's group believes that that ADHD is quite possibly a harbinger of susceptibility to bipolar disorder. So you have a person going along who's an ADHD type and something traumatic happens to them. Sometimes it can be just life stress, like having to graduate from high school. Often it's sexual abuse. Some shock occurs within the family or to that particular individual and they slip into bipolar. So there's reason to believe that that could be linked with ADHD. Here's a plot between seafood intake and the frequency of bipolar disorder. The less seafood that's eaten is the more the lifetime prevalence rate. This is in percent, so this is 7% bipolar disorder in these countries, whereas in Iceland, who consume 200 pounds or more per person per year, there is virtually no bipolar disorder. And the break point is around somewhere around 50 to 100 pounds of fish a year, which translates to a couple of meals per week. And I don't really have time to go through this, just to tell you that something is wrong in the signal transduction mechanism in bipolar disorder. And Dr. David Horbin, before he died, put forward a very nice, very reasonable hypothesis that it's the availability of omega-3s that determines how a person cycles in bipolar disorder. When they have enough omega-3s, they go manic. And when they run out of omega-3s and they become depressed, and you give them back omega-3s and they come back up. And we also see omega-3 deficiency in clinical depression. There have been a number of trials there. And interestingly, Horobin put forward he's not the only one who has the belief that there's a continuum between going from bipolar disorder to depression to schizoaffective disorder and into schizophrenia. But there's a great overlap between the symptoms and the genes that are involved, and so, and he believes that you have this kind of three different overlaps that occur, and depending on what the gene combinations are, these individuals will have a predilection for these extremes of behavior. But clinically, it seems there's substantial overlap between all of them. In bipolar patients, we see white matter hyperintensities, and this actually was a picture taken from a woman with Crohn's disease. And the white matter hyperintensity looks for all the world like multiple sclerosis. And we see similar bodies in people who have bipolar. And we also find that in multiple sclerosis, people with MS tend to have depression. And the more white matter hyperintensities they have, in black here, the higher they score on all the depression tests. So here are four different depression tests. And here's an MS patient with here's a number of non-white matter hyperintensities, and they're scoring low. And then those that have more hyperintensities score more on the depression test. So essentially, the more of these bodies there are in the brain, and they are inflammatory end product bodies, is the more depressed the patient is. So we've had five trials on depression. Three of them worked. One of them used olive oil as a placebo, which I think was a bad idea because it's unsaturated. And it may be that that's why we didn't get a significant difference. But the trials that used, one trial used DHA by itself and got a negative outcome. We've had other trials in other mood disorders where EPA was used alone. So the take-home message from that is that you should take DHA and EPA in roughly, I believe, equal amounts. And you should take, well, I'm coming to that slide. This is the funeral of a young woman who was in a clinical trial with a new SSRI drug, and she committed suicide in the laboratory of the drug company. Okay, so the deal is that minors should not get SSRIs, period. They just should not get them. Gotta find another way. It's another scandal that's being hidden. ADHD, autism, there's all evidence there. All the disorders, there's a spectrum in kids too, apparently, between dyslexia, the various dyslexias, ADHD, and going into autism. So that's also apparently a genic overlap. And all of those tend to respond to some degree to omega-3s, and all of them have detectable inflammation operated. Here are all the people who don't do well making long-chain fatty acids, and you'll see yourself in one of those groups. You know, who is there around who doesn't have one of these problems, right? All these people are unlikely to be able to make sufficient EPA and DHA from flaxseed oil or from alpha-linolenic. Okay, what I'll do, I'll transform this into a PDF and put it on my website, and then you can go download it, okay? Because I know I've gone very fast. I'm sorry to have been so unreasonable, but. So for maintenance, in a 22-year-old healthy person, 850 milligrams of EPA plus DHA. So that's not just one capsule of fish oil. That's like, you gotta look at the amount of EPA and DHA in the capsule and make sure you get 850. American Heart Association recommends above 1 gram a day. I would say more like 2 or 3. Although FDA says that 3 grams are unsafe. I have no idea where they got that from. And for mood disorders, you have to get way above 3 grams. And there's some controversy over this, but the only way to really know your omega-3 status is to have your red cells looked at, have your blood drawn and sent to a lab. And if you're, let's just say that if you're below 8% in omega-3s, you need to work harder. So somewhere above 8% omega-3s is where you want to be. so-called omega-3 index. And don't have time to really go into it tonight, but the phospholipids, the omega-3s, and the antioxidants all work together. You can't use them separately. If you use the antioxidants and you don't use the omega-3s, your membranes are not properly set up. If you use the omega-3s and you don't use antioxidants, the omega-3s, having double bonds, can spontaneously explode in the membrane, literally explode. Just the bond breaks, you get free radicals formed, you get a ripple of free radical formation through the membrane, and pow, I've seen it under the microscope too, in my sea urchin eggs. You know, you get this, first the cell puts out a bleb, it just develops like a weak spot, and the cytoplasm starts leaking out, and then it just blows up and everything just goes to pieces. Now, fish oil products that do not have substantial added antioxidants pose that kind of risk. And if you have doubts, you want to ask your supplier, do you have enough antioxidants in it? How much do you have? Have you done stability testing to assure me that over a year or a year and a half or 2 years, the material stays stable? And also, you should be clear that your inflammatory balance will depend on your omega-3, omega-6 balance and your antioxidant balance. And the best antioxidants for this are vitamin E, alpha and gamma, and the others, CoQ, and some number of carotenoids, but mixed carotenoids, not just beta carotene. But finally, in the cell, the ultimate antioxidant balance depends on the amount of glutathione inside the cell. And ultimately, the amount of glutathione is best regulated by the intake of vitamin C, of ascorbate. The more ascorbate you take, the more glutathione you can conserve. So Bob developed this hypothesis of the bucket brigade. So vitamin C brings in the electrons. It's the most cost-effective antioxidants you can get, right? So the vitamin C brings in the electrons, the protective electrons, gets them to glutathione, and glutathione keeps things quiet inside the cell. But within the membrane, just to be sure that your membranes are working right, you need E, CoQ, and carotenoids. And so someday, when I'm free of stress, I'll be relaxing on the beach, but I'm still going to have with me my vitamin C and my antioxidant balanced fish oil and my multivitamin mineral that I designed myself, and then I just relax and, you know, just get as much time as I can and hope that I don't lose my mind before I lose my body. But honestly, there's a lot that, if I can leave you with this tonight, there's a lot that you can do, and it really is up to you. Just don't go for the magic bullets. Don't go for the quick promotional messages. Go with an integrated program. David Perlmutter has written a book called The Better Brain Book, and I think it really is a pretty good book. David Perlmutter, Better Brain Book. And I'm doing another small book on PS, which will be out soon. Then I'll do a book on GPC. Then I'll do a bigger book on omega-3s. Well, so you can keep checking out my website for that. www.dockkid.com. You can write me at dockkid@dockkid.com. And phospholipids online has a lot of stuff on phospholipids. Yeah, that's me. I help with it, but it's an educational website on phospholipids. But you can get pretty much everything we've talked about tonight. Give me about a week to post tonight's talk on there. But my reviews I reviewed cognitive decline, Parkinson's, multiple sclerosis, ADHD, autism in two parts, and bipolar in alternative medicine review, so you can get that from the Thorne website or from my website.
Can you go back to what you got on there a minute ago?
Go back to where?
The last slide. It had all cash.
Yeah, sure, sure. Yeah.
Can we go 5 minutes of questions? Is that all right?
Yeah.
Okay, good.
The supplements that you are financially invested in, are they also on your website?
I can tell you, they're PS, GPC, and DHA.
So how can we get them?
How
can we get them?
Yeah. You can ask for them from any supplier whom you trust. All the suppliers, all the retailers know about them now. And some people have hesitated and some people have gone through. Jarrow has them, Natural Factors has them. American Biologics has GPC, and I'm now doing quality control for a company called Crayon Research. I don't know if you ever met Robert Crayon, but there's a really brilliant fellow, and Crayon Research has a bulk liquid fish oil with quite a bit of CoQ in it, so you spoon that out. Now, if you want to go for mood regulation, you're probably going to have to use the bulk oil because you just can't get enough through the capsules. If you just want to go with maintenance, you can go to Ocean Nutrition or any of your trusted suppliers and get the capsules, but just make sure that you add up the EPA and DHA in the capsule, not just how much fish oil there is. Yeah.
Can you say something about Siraphos? How that compares with phosphatidylserine.
Siraphos
is a lot less expensive than
it is. I want to go on TV with this. Siraphos is fake. Siraphos has no role in human metabolism. Siraphos can cause cardiac bradycardia in women. I've got calls about that. Siraphos is an unethical product. That's what I think about Siraphos. No phosphatidylserine in it, not orthomolecular, and the way the label is designed, they put the serine next to the phosphorus. You notice that? But it's nothing resembling a phospholipid, and especially not phosphatidylserine. And I contacted them and talked to them, and that was like 7 or 8 years ago, and they still carry it, you know. So sue me. Yeah.
In an article in the New York Times this week, they were talking about the preservative used in MMR for children, and they said they were using a methylmercury.
Yeah, yeah. It's thimerosal. It's a mercury compound. You know, early in this century, in the last century, you know, I span the centuries too. Early in the 19th century, they had a powder, like a kind of, you know, baby diaper powder that had mercury in it. And the kids started to get all kinds of weird stuff. And it was actually called, I think, white diaper disease or something like that. And kids were doing very badly. And finally, under pressure, pardon?
Pink's disease.
Pink disease, yeah. Yeah, and they finally had to remove it from the market. And everywhere I look in brain disorders, in ADHD, autism, Parkinson's, multiple sclerosis, Alzheimer's, everywhere I look I see mercury. And next week I'm going to visit Dr. Rashid Buttar, who's been working on detoxifying autistic kids from mercury. And I'm going to work with him to see what he can publish in a peer-reviewed journal. And I'm thinking that we adults should be doing the DMPS as well. Maybe you're going to help me with that, Bob. It looks like a DMPS is better. And he has a transdermal DMPS. But I'm thinking that every year or two, we should start that and then track our urine and see how much mercury comes out. Yeah.
What's the oral dose of the GPC? Most of what you had was IV and all the...
Yeah, 600 to 1,200 milligrams. 1,200 milligrams is a therapeutic dose. 600 milligrams increases brain choline levels by 50%, and I'm comfortably recommending that as a routine maintenance dose.
Would that be additive with PC, and
I don't buy into Huperzine at all. I don't like Huperzine. I think Huperzine's only destiny is as an antidote for nerve gas. It's like a total blocker of acetylcholinesterase. And I just don't like it at all. I just very uncomfortable with it. Very uncomfortable. And you know, how many people eat club moss, you know? You know, I mean, at least when I went to Japan, I got a ginkgo nut, right? You know, in a soup, right? People don't eat Chinese club moss. You know, they just don't, you know? I'm very concerned about Huperzine. But if you want to talk about an integrated program, PSMGPC, in terms of the clinical data, are at the top. Acetylcarnitine, then comes ginkgo. But then you have fast-closing players like alpha-lipoic acid and CoQ10. And so you want to put those into the program, and generous amounts of those. Yeah, back there.
What about the possibility of bleeding disorders with too much fish oil?
Yeah, they are lowering blood viscosity, but I would think that unless a person is on a drug, wouldn't worry about it too much. However, you know, when I see 10 grams for bipolar, I get a little bit nervous. But looking at the damage that bipolar can do to a person and to their family, I suppose the physician could monitor viscosity or, you know, find some balance. But of course, you're going to have an integrated program for the bipolar patient as well. And that's also in my review of bipolar disorder. In all of those reviews, I've attempted to develop the best I could for an integrated protocol, not being a physician myself. Yes?
What about, you think, evening primrose oil?
GLA, good stuff. It's a nice non-inflammatory backup, but it's not an omega-3. It may be useful for some people who are not metabolizing well. But I don't see it as integral to this program. Not among meat eaters, anyway. It's a good question, though. Really a good question. Yes, Paul.
I'm Paris. I always tell patients to put on cod liver oil at high doses to look out for extra bleeding or bruising.
Yeah.
We do get some people that will get a bloody nose, yeah, or they bruise more and they have to cut it down there.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's a biochemical individuality thing.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure it is. And I'm thinking with the mood disorders that you know, maybe you have to use your judgment in terms of how many grams you would give them, but they do need a lot. And I'm also thinking that, you know, this was done by a guy at Harvard, right? And that's partly why it's such a, you know, big deal, this trial that was done. But I'm thinking that you give 10 grams and you get a benefit over 4 months, but maybe if you gave 3 grams, you could straighten them out in 6 or 7 months. And that's where you go and look at the red cells. Once you can get the red cells above 8%, then you know you're on track, and maybe you can ease them back or something. But if you have a person who's really badly off, maybe you can jam them for 3 or 4 weeks with a high dose, check the red cells, and then see how they're moving along, and then bring the dose down. In other words, titrate it just like we titrate other things. Mike.
How about the comparison between fish oil and tarot oil? I believe the fish oil is even more, at least the Roman Catholic is using twice as much as the tarot oil.
Yeah, you know, you can get really potent fish oils, and I think there's a certain gap between maintenance and reasonably healthy people, or even people who want to prevent heart attack and stroke, and then people who really have major problems, as with arthritis, inflammatory bowel disease, and mood disorders. So I think you kind of have to look at each person and assess whether you can give them a cod liver oil, which of course, you know, carries the vitamin A or so. I don't know, you have any comments on that, Bob? Do you?
Well, I haven't had any trouble with vitamin A toxicity with cod liver oil. Just every once in a while you'll have a person that loses and bleeds.
Yeah, yeah. Do you send them for the red cell tests or?
I haven't, but I will.
Yeah, it might be worth trying. Well, I got new ones. Let me take somebody else and I'll come back to you. Yes.
There's a common source of PC and PS. Just plain old lecithin that Dell Davis talked about 30 years ago, a great source.
There's like 0.1% of PS in lecithin, and there's some PC. But what I'm actually saying these days is that, but you know, to get the amount of PS that's necessary, it's not really going to work. And to get the amount of PC that you need for the liver, you need a whole bunch of lecithin, because the PC for the liver is around somewhere between 1,200 and 1,400 milligrams a day. So it kind of gets a bit difficult, but I still believe, you know, lecithin might have been the original health food. It was already on sale in Germany in the 1910s, 1915s as a health food. And if people want to sprinkle it on their cereals and stuff, that's fine. Just make sure that it's good, clean stuff. Bert, then I come back to you.
Two things. One, on the, there's a huge study going on right now on grass-fed beef showing that the omega-3s are exceptionally good for that and equals amounts of what fish oils are.
Yeah.
And then another thing, we just finished a study with the National Cancer Research Foundation, if anybody wants the information. We use cod liver oil with a nutritional protocol. We've seen in our PET scan, CAT scan, all the tumors within 1 to 3 months completely regress almost to where there's no tumors at all.
Yeah, I would support.
Everybody wants to talk to the patients. They have all their scans, and they can tell you that.
Yeah, I would support cod liver oil.
We did not use fish oil, and it didn't work as well.
Yeah, I would support.
Dr. Muro has shown that above 1,000 milligrams of fish oil per day will increase cancer. Where below that, he has shown that it doesn't.
That I find a little bit hard to digest.
Yeah, Dr. Muro has done some interesting studies.
But anyway,
just got back to seeing him.
Okay, so people can follow up with you on that, right? Yeah. Okay. And let me just come back to you really quickly.
Therapeutic dose of fossil serum.
Pardon?
Therapeutic dose of fossil serum.
300 milligrams, but you can go up to 600 quite readily. And I even recommend the higher doses for somebody who's really in trouble. You know, when you begin to notice your friend or relative, that's the last time. That's the last chance. Gotta get in there. You gotta get them on a major, major program, including stress reduction, meditation, all the nutrients, whatever. And the drugs, the drugs can have some efficacy, but they only last for about a year, year and a half or so. So you can only come in with the drugs in the last stages, last ditch. Otherwise, you gotta go with the nutrients. Yes.
Two questions. One has to do with using supplies of fish that have been dyed, because most of the stuff you pick up at Costco now and Raley's are dyed salmons.
It's astaxanthin, and it's a pretty good carotenoid, but that's not the problem. The problem is how they raise them.
The farm. So yeah, not to use this source.
No,
so
no, you gotta go wild. Gotta go wild. $10 a pound.
Okay. And then the second question has...
$10 a pound, but I think it's worth it. $10, $11. Wild Alaskan, preferably sockeye.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, preferably sockeye, yeah. I love it.
The second question is, have you done any kind of endocrine overlay studies on any of these studies you've been doing? Because it seems to me again and again and again and again, and everything you were talking about tonight, you probably are looking at reduced endocrine levels on one sort or another. Especially when you talk about relationships between the hippocampus and the pituitary and stuff. Mm-hmm. So I'm wondering, have you done those?
No. And you know, my feeling about the hormonal thing is that very, very tricky, very high level regulation. And if you're gonna get into it, you better get into it seriously. And you better measure everything all the way along. Be very, very careful and measure as you go along. No question in my mind that the hormonal adjustments are appropriate and necessary. The only exception, and I had to go through it very quickly, was with the use of injectable GPC to increase endogenous release of growth hormone. It's a real phenomenon. It does happen. There's no point in my mind to talk a lot about it until we've also done it orally. But for people who really have a major growth hormone problem, it might be worth doing the injectable GPC, which is available from College Pharmacy.
But wouldn't it be better to do it transdermally, though, especially in that case?
No, not transdermally, because we're not talking about adding we're not talking about adding growth hormone. Is that what you're talking about?
No, I was actually talking about every single other hormone that seems to be an issue right now. But the fact that you would be stimulating that really brings that really more to focus.
No, we're not stimulating it.
You would be stimulating growth hormone by adding...
No, we're not. No. We're actually revitalizing the pituitary. The pituitary manages growth hormone tone through sets of stimulatory and inhibitory, mostly cholinergic synapses, which are driven by acetylcholine. And apparently GPC, injected daily over a period of time, can normalize, balance to some extent that cholinergic tone and cause a greater growth hormone release upon stimulation with a natural growth hormone releaser, GHRH. And interestingly, old people have a better enhancement of growth hormone release than young people. And that's kind of a tip-off that it is physiologic. So we're talking about getting into the brain and revitalizing the brain and helping the brain to, by giving these orthomolecular substances, allowing the brain to do what it wants to do by giving it the tools that it needs.
This has been a terrific talk. Thank you very much. So those of you who have other questions, the parents will be around for a while, and I invite you to come down and talk to them.